What is real manhood?
Do you know?
There are a lot of caricatures of manhood out there. Is it about making money and being successful? Or does it mean killing things and eating their bloody hearts? Maybe it's getting in touch with your emotions. Really in touch. A man has to be macho, right? You don't let anyone disrespect you. Maybe it's about being known as the ultimate family man. Or maybe it's all about being the most dedicated fan. Is manhood really about playing by all the rules? Or being the busiest man at church? Don't let the world tell you what it means to be a man. God has so much more for you than this. Are you up for the challenge?
All right, so we're going on this journey to biblical manhood. So as we're talking about real biblical manhood, you know, I think what we're going to start with, we're going to start by considering the Bible. Even our title, saying that we're on a journey to biblical manhood, really sort of sets the stage. It gives us some parameters for what we're going to talk about. We're aspiring to biblical manhood. So an important question to ask is the Bible even the appropriate place to go to develop what our definition of manhood is? And I would say that it is. And here's why. I think if you look at the Bible, you can see a remarkable book. This is a book that was written by dozens of authors over centuries. The main proposition of the scriptures is remarkably consistent, especially when you think about the time span, the culture span, the authorship span that's present throughout the 66 books in the Bible. I'm not going to wow you with the details of how the Bible was constructed. There's lots of great resources. You can go online or you can buy books. There's some great books like Knowing Scripture by R.C. Sproul that you might want to look at, and tons of other books like that that can really help you see how the Bible came together. But what I want you to realize is that all the authors of all the books of the Bible written all over all of those centuries, they keep talking about the same thing over and over and over again. They talk about a personal God who created us, who chooses us, who loves us, who pursues us. They talk about a just God who demands perfection and clearly explains what he means by perfection. It talks about a holy God, a God who's not superhuman or just like a higher form of one of us, but actually a whole different being, a being so outside of ourselves that it's one God and three persons. And the names that are used to try to describe God throughout the Bible, there are literally hundreds of different ways that God is referred to in the Bible just in an effort to describe who he is. The authors talk about a powerful but a temperate God. A God who made everything and holds it together moment by moment. And the Bible talks about a redemptive God, a God who satisfies his own sense of justice on our behalf by substituting his own son to pay the penalty for us. This is the story of the Bible. It's remarkably consistent. And so first and foremost, the Bible tells us who God is and what God wants and what God did. There's a famous theologian in the 20th century named Carl Henry, and he gives a great one-sentence explanation of what the Bible is. He wrote this series of books. It takes a big space on your shelf. It's called God, Revelation, and Authority. And he puts forth a series of theses or arguments about setting up a systematic theology. But he writes a great thesis. Thesis 11 is this. He says, In fact, I think I have it up here. The Bible is the reservoir and conduit of divine truth, the authoritative written record and exposition of God's nature and will. The reservoir and conduit of divine truth, the authoritative written record and exposition of God's nature and will. This would be a great big idea if any of us could actually remember it, okay? So I've made it easier, okay? So here's the big idea. The Bible guides me to the truth every time. The Bible guides me to the truth every time. That's our big idea. That's what Carl Henry was saying. And so we're going to look at three ways that the Bible guides us to truth, all right? So the first way is that the Bible guides us to a right view of the world. The Bible guides us to a right way to live. And the Bible guides us to new affections. To a right view of the world, a right way to live, and to new affections. So let's start with looking at a right view of the world. If you have a Bible, turn to Genesis 2. And let me show you an example of how the Bible guides us to a right view of the world. You may have heard me say this before, but let me say it again. The Bible perfectly explains why the world works the way it works. If you're wondering why evil exists, why anybody would ever do anything selfless, why it's hard at work, why marriage is so difficult and what it takes to make it successful. You can't think of a question or a problem that you can come up with that the answer to it is not in the scriptures. So let me give you an example from Genesis 2. So let's just talk about, this is just sort of, Genesis 2 and Genesis 3 give us like probably the greatest explanation of how the world works sort of at a foundational level. So Genesis 2, if you start at Genesis 2:15, you see this verse. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and keep it. To work it and keep it. This is before the fall. A lot of people say, oh, the work is the result of the fall. No. Work is the result of God's design. Why do guys like to work? Why do guys like to accomplish things? Because that's how God made us. God took Adam, put him in the garden to work it and keep it. Then verse 18, then the Lord God said, it's not good that the man should be alone. It's not good that men should be alone. Men who are alone turn into the Unabomber, right? Men who are alone turn into people that are not good really for very much and sometimes violent and scary. Men need to be with somebody. We know this. We need to be in relationship with each other. We need, many of us find a completeness in being married, which then go down to verse 24. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. So we get a picture of what a marriage looks like when a marriage works well, is that it's the husband and wife becoming one flesh. And then chapter 3. I think Genesis 3 probably does more to explain why the world works the way it works than any other chapter in the Bible. So we have this story, right? The serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, did God actually say, you shall not eat of any tree in the garden? And so here we see the way that Satan works and even the way that our flesh works. We take things that we know to be true and then we twist them. We twist them to our own needs, to our own desires. You see this all around you, right? Have you ever had a conversation with somebody and they like use your words against you and you're like, I didn't mean that. That's not what I said. And yet they're like quoting back to you exactly what you said. If you have teenagers, you've definitely had this experience, right? Well, why does the world work like that? Well, the Bible shows us this is how it works. This is exactly how it works. Our words get twisted around. The woman says, we can eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but God said, you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the midst of the garden, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. But the serpent said to the woman, and I think this was his tone too, you will not surely die. Come on. Again, teenager, right? That's not going to happen. For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was a delight to the eyes and that it was desire to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband who was with her. The knucklehead, right? Standing there the whole time, watching it happen. How often do we do that? How often do we just stand there and watch bad things happen? Things that we know aren't right. How many marriages would be better if a guy would step up when he sees his wife headed down a path that's not the right path for her? How many marriages would be better if when one or the other of the spouses gets engaged in a situation or in a problem, the other one doesn't just go, "Oh, I wonder how you're going to do with that one." But we don't. We don't step in. The Bible tells us right from the start with Adam and Eve, this is where the problem started, was with a lie from a serpent twisting God's words, and then the, I don't know if you call it cowardice or just apathy of a man standing there watching it all happen. Then the eyes of both were open. They knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together, and they made themselves loincloths. And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. What do men do when they get in trouble? They isolate, right? They hide, just like the Bible says. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" So up until this point, God has been a creator, right? He's been this powerful creator of the heavens and the earth. He's been this assigner of task to the man. He's to the role of men and to the role of a woman. You know, a woman is there to be a helpmate, someone that's beside the man, working in conjunction with him, right? And now we see a new part of God. We see God the pursuer. Where are you? Did God know where he was? Yeah, he knew where he was. Do you know what he'd done? Yeah, he knew what he had done, but that's what a pursuer does. A pursuer comes after you. A pursuer comes after you, and that's the God that we worship. And he said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked." So you have shame comes into the world, right? Guilt was there when they bit the apple, but shame comes when it makes you hide from God. There's a difference. Guilt is like a legal standing. You either did something or you didn't do something. But shame is the result of guilt when you decide instead to step into it and repent and ask for forgiveness, and then the guilt is removed. Shame says, no, I'm going to keep my guilt. Thank you very much. This is it's too scary to be honest. So instead, I'll just keep my guilt. You see people like this around you? If they would just confess, if they would just say this is what I did, people would go, "All right, we can deal with that." Right? Your kids. How many of you have had a kid that just looked you in the eye when you knew what they had done and they just stuck to their guilt? Just like the Bible says. It's just like the Bible says. So I love God's answer. Who told you were naked? Like, who told you that was even a problem, right? And so, again, we take things that are normal and natural and we twist them around and we make them bad, just like the scriptures say we do. "Have you eaten of the tree which I commanded you not to eat?" And then the man said, the woman who you gave me, like, I'm going to blame everybody I can and not take responsibility, "gave me the fruit of the tree, and I ate." I mean, I feel like he's saying, that woman you gave me and the serpent, they tied me up, held me down, and shoved fruit down my throat. I mean, that's almost kind of the tone here, right? "Then the Lord God said to the woman, 'Who is this that, what is this that you have done?' And she blames the serpent," right? So Adam blames the woman and God, and then Eve blames the serpent. Nobody wants to take responsibility for anything. It perfectly explains how the world works. And then God gives the curse. He curses the serpent first, then he curses the woman, right? By the way, the curse for the woman, like the childbirth curse, that's just the appetizer, all right? The worst curse is the last part of it. "Your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you." Poor ladies. So you're trying to figure out, well, I don't understand this. Why would a woman stay in an abusive relationship? Because her desire is for her husband and he will rule over her. It's the consequence of sin for the man. Because you've listened to the voice of your wife and not what? And not God. Because you've chosen to listen to your wife and not to me. It's not about the wife, it's about Adam. And have eaten of the tree of which I commanded you not to eat, cursed is the ground because of you. In pain you shall eat of it all the days of your life, thorns and thistles that shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your face, verse 19, you shall eat bread. Now, did Adam have a job before? Did he have work before? Did he harvest the grain before? Did he make bread before? Yeah, absolutely. Only now it's by the sweat of your face you shall eat bread. And so what we see is the Bible explaining what happened to the world. The world was supposed to work a certain way, and sin corrupted it. And when you understand the Bible, you understand the corruption of sin. You understand how it takes everything that God made that was good, and it tainted it. And so, you know, the thing you have to remember about sin is this. We tend to think about sin as the actions that we engage in, like I sinned, I did a sin, right? And that is sin. But sin is much more pernicious than that. Sin isn't just the actions that we do. Sin is the consequences of the corruption of God's creation. So childbirth didn't used to be hard. Anybody been in the room when a baby was born? Not so good, huh? Right? I mean, even with drugs. Now the sweat of our brow is what it takes for us to accomplish anything. And so you see the work that was a good thing becomes corrupted. It becomes hard. And even more than that, men start worshiping things other than God. So they worship their wives like Adam did. They worship their kids. They worship their work. And so the Bible perfectly explains how the world works. It gives you a right view of the world right from the very start. If you let me give you a New Testament example of this. If you flip over to Ephesians and look at Ephesians chapter 2 and the first three verses. You were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked. And now listen to this. Following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air. Who's that? Prince of the power of the air. Satan, right? The spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. The world, the flesh, and the devil. This is the passage that we get that concept from, that we fight against three things that are pulling us away from God. The world is telling us how we should live our life, right? Satan's whispering in our ear, telling us how we should live our life. And then our own flesh is desiring of that. James talks about the cycle of sin, the cycle of temptation, and the language that he uses is that sin is like he uses fisherman talk. Sin is like bait dangling in the water. Why does bait work? Because we want to eat what the bait is. You don't bait. You know, nobody's baiting guys with pictures of broken down cars. They're baiting us with Corvettes and Lamborghinis, right? So the bait is our flesh is attracted to it. But inside that bait is what? Is a hook. Is death, James says, right? The Bible perfectly explains the way the world works, guys. If you're wondering why it's so hard, it's hard because of corruption. It's hard because of sin. And it's all in here. So then, if the Bible gives us a right view of the world, it's guiding us to truth, right? This is our big idea. The Bible guides me to the truth every time. So the Bible also then gives us a right way to live. A right way to live. Think of the greatest struggles that men face. Think of just about any issue that's in your life that you're struggling with. Let's take money, okay? Jesus talks about money in the Gospels more than anything else. There are 2,350 verses in the entire Bible about money. That's what Howard Dayton said. In fact, you can go to this website right here. I made a little website, tinyurl.com/moneyverses, tinyurl.com/moneyverses. And there are all 2,350 verses organized by topic. If you're struggling with money, or if you don't want to struggle with money, download that from Crown Ministries, and you can see all the different verses organized by topic about money. The Bible helps us figure out how to live life the right way. What does the Bible say about money? Well, Deuteronomy 10:14 reminds us that it's all God's. Behold, to the Lord your God belong heaven and the highest heavens, the earth and all that is in it. It reminds us that everything comes from him in 1 Chronicles 29:14. It reminds us what our responsibilities are with money, like helping the poor, supporting the work of missionaries and the church, providing for our families, even investing wisely. All of these principles about money are all throughout the Bible. Dave Ramsey, Howard Dayton, these guys have made a ministry, a mission of their life about helping families use their money effectively, using nothing but biblical wisdom. And people that follow those principles, their finances are in good shape. If you follow the principles. What about marriage, right? Well, Genesis tells us that a husband and wife are like one flesh. So if you're going to live like your wife is one flesh with you, how do you treat your body? Right? You don't ignore it. You don't push it aside. You don't make other things a higher priority than that. I mean, like we've said here, like Pat has said, after God, but before all others, make your wife your top priority. Why does he say that? Because that's what the scripture says. It says we're one flesh. It says to wives, submit to your husbands. But it also says to husbands, love your wives like Christ loved the church. Hey, she has to submit. We have to die. All right? So, I'm a feminist today. All right?
You missed a bunch of days.
Yeah. But you understand what I'm saying? The Bible's not one-sided. It gives all of us a right way to live, a right way to view things so that we make the decisions that make our lives better. This is what it means to pursue biblical manhood. What about parenting? The Bible gives us all kinds of admonitions about proper discipline, right? Spare the rod, spoil the child. But it also says, don't exasperate your children. And you can go all throughout scriptures. You can see the way that God treats his children, us, and you can see the admonitions that the Bible has all throughout Proverbs, all throughout Paul's letters. And Peter says the same kinds of things, the way that we're supposed to treat our families. It's all in the book. There's literally no problem or dilemma that I can think of that you can face that you cannot find at least a biblical principle that can help you make the best choices in that area. The Bible contains the wisdom you need. It guides you to the right way to live. So the Bible guides me to the truth, and it does it every time. Then the third thing is that the Bible does is that it guides us to new affections. It guides us to new affections. And there's something about God's word that illustrates its power. The power of the scriptures is that it is actually the living word of God. Like, I like to read, but I read a book. Sometimes I'll read a book twice, but like after that, like I'm done with it, right? But there's passages that I read in the Bible that every time I read them, I get something new out of them, right? How is that? I mean, I read a story in a book or even a nonfiction book about some business principle or something, and it says the same thing every time. No matter how many times I read it, it always says the same thing. And yet, the words don't change in the Bible, but my understanding of what it means gets deeper and deeper and deeper every time. There is no logical explanation for that. It's just the power of the Spirit of God in the book. When you spend time in the Bible, you change. Look at Galatians 5. When you spend time in the Word, when you spend time in the presence of God, something happens to you. Look at Galatians 5:22. This is a pretty famous passage. This is the fruits of the Spirit's passage. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Now let me tell you what this is not. This is not a list of things to aspire to. You cannot aspire to love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control in your own power. What you can do is you can spend enough time in the Word, enough time in the presence of God, that the Spirit, this is the fruits of the Spirit. Not, it doesn't say the fruits of good old-fashioned hard work are. The fruits of you trying as hard as you can to be holy and righteous and good, it's not about you. When you spend time in the Word, the affections of your heart begin to change. You're struggling with your marriage? Spend time in the Word. God will start to change your heart. You've got a problem, child? Spend time in the Word. God will start changing your heart towards your child. You've got an enemy? You've got a problem with anger or sadness? Spend time in the Word, and God will start to change your heart. Spend time with people that can point you to the Word, and God will start to change the affections of your heart. The Bible guides us to the truth every time. So let me share one final thought as far as a Bible verse goes, and then we're going to go to the tables. This is James 1:22-25. He says this, "But be doers of the Word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he's like a man who looks intently at his natural face in a mirror, for he looks at himself and goes away at once and forgets what he was like. But the one who looks into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and perseveres, being no hearer who forgets, but a doer who acts, he will be blessed in his doing." The Bible guides me to truth every time. So I want to show you a couple things really quick here. I want to really encourage you to get into the Bible, and then as you get into the Bible, you're going to want to learn more about it. You're going to want to learn more how to use it. So let me show you a couple books. One is this book by Donald Whitney called Spiritual Disciplines for the Christian Life. If you want some good practical tools for how to get into the Word, the first couple chapters of Spiritual Disciplines for the Christian Life are great. Is a great book to read. And then if you want to talk about a book that has pulled out verses on lots of different topics, this book is called Godly Counsel, and it's by Brian Campbell in collaboration with the Reverend Jim Angelakis. So Jim has helped to put a book together that goes through and grabs, I don't know, several hundred scriptures, again, putting them topically. So I want to encourage you to go read, you know, you need to study the Bible, but you might also look for books that can help you understand Scripture even better, because the Bible guides us to truth every time. We need to know how to understand it. So we've got four questions on the table talk time this morning, and here's what we're going to do. We're going to break to the tables here in about 30 seconds, but we're going to come back about 4 minutes before 8 o'clock. And so at 4 minutes of eight, we're going to come back, and I'm going to point to tables, and I'm going to ask you what you came up with in answer to these questions, all right? So I'm going to ask you for what you came up with for these questions. So let me encourage you to do something, okay? I really want you guys to talk about Jimmy Garoppolo's Instagram post at 4 o'clock this morning that makes everybody think the Patriots are trading him, or what the latest tweet is that came out of the president's office. I want you to talk about that after eight. Okay? So I'm violating a little bit of a principle here. The principle is that there's a couple people, if there's a big group of people and one or two people are sort of doing something that you don't want them to do, just talk to those people individually. But I'm telling everybody, all right? I really want to encourage you to maximize the potential of the next 20 minutes of your time to interact with each other at the tables around the biblical stuff that we're talking about. And then save the politics and the weather and the sports and the other stuff. You know, pray for each other. Take that worldly stuff and just put it off till 8 o'clock. All right? Is that all right to ask that? Yeah, no. All right. So that's my encouragement for you this morning. I'll see you in about 20 minutes, and we'll see what guys came up with for a few of these questions. Go ahead and break to the table. Let me pray for you, and then we'll break to the tables. Father, thank you so much for your word. It inspires us, Lord. It informs us. It educates us. It trains us, and it changes us. So, Father, I pray that over the next few minutes here and then throughout the rest of this weekend and this week, this next week, that you would draw us, you would compel us into your scriptures, Lord, that we would have a hunger and a thirst to know you better through what you've revealed through your word. So, Father, be with us over the next few minutes, Lord, and bless our time together. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, guys. Wow, that was some good, that was great discussion, and nobody like ran out the door. That's a good sign. So these were interesting questions. How would you describe the Bible to someone who is unfamiliar with it? Just right there.
It'd be like a way I look at it is talk to somebody, find out what their interest is. If they're in many cars, they've got a car manual to do the cars. So the Bible is like that.
Wow, what a great, he said, you talk to a guy, find out what he's into, like a guy's into cars, you can sell, like the Bible's kind of like the owner's manual for your car, but for your life. That's great, that's good. Anybody else, how would you describe the Bible to someone that's unfamiliar with it?
I think you got one good shot when somebody asks you that. Tell them something that they want to hear. This is a book on how to be successful.
A book on how to be successful. Ultimately true, right? Last one. The world's bestseller. That is very true. The Bible is still the world's bestseller. Good. Who can remember a time where biblical guidance actually helped you through a situation? Anybody got a story? All right, we're going to do one story here.
Just time after time again.
Over and over again. Good.
Scripture for the day, scripture for the moment, scripture for the problem.
Seems like what you need right at the right time.
Yeah.
Anybody else got something specific? Awesome.
Psalm 51.
Yeah.
David's great confession. It's, do not take your Holy Spirit from me.
Mm-hmm.
I read that a lot.
That's good. Psalm 51, do not take your Holy Spirit from me. What are some guides that people use to help them live their lives outside of the Bible?
Man in the mirror.
Man in the mirror, okay.
Bible studies.
So Bible studies. What about some? What are some bad ways? Go ahead.
Well, media, TV, yeah. Government.
Yeah, the media, TV, government. I mean, here's the thing. People that go. Well, I don't need the Bible. I'm not gonna have anybody telling me what to do. Well, that's just false logic, right? Everybody has somebody telling them what to do. Everybody's bought into a worldview that they're getting from somewhere. Right? They're getting a worldview from cable news. They're getting a worldview from movies. They're getting a worldview from TV shows. They're getting a worldview from their friends. When I was in college, my worldview came from my fraternity brothers. The things they valued, I valued. The things they spurned, I spurned. Right? Just look at my GPA. We were all smart. No, just kidding. All right. Last one. Yeah, self-help books. Very good.
Yeah,
very good. Some of these gurus like Tony Robbins and people like that. People go to all different places to form their worldviews. It's really not any, there's really no reason that a man couldn't look at the Bible to get his worldview just as easily as he watches TV or reads self-help books or talks to his, it's one of the things that he has to choose from. Let's not make it more odd than it really, it's not odd at all. In fact, it's the oldest book around, set of books around, and it stood the test of time. 200 years from now, nobody's going to have heard of any of these self-help guys. 200 years from now, nobody's going to have, there probably won't even be a CNN 200 years from now, right? But I'll guarantee you one thing, the Bible will be there. The Bible will be there. What are some topics you think the Bible could help a man with in his life? What's maybe a passage that helps guys give guidance with a specific issue? Anybody have any of that? John.
Our consensus was the most important thing we get from the Bible is seeking counsel.
Good. So most important thing from the Bible is that the Bible encourages you to seek counsel. Good. Anything else? Any other specific? Yep.
The Bible teaches you about the God and God's love for us.
Good. So when you're doubting that, is there a passage that you go to look at to remind yourself?
I've got a different resource that I use.
Okay. Okay.
It's a summation over years, people who have had near-death experiences gone and come back.
Yeah, so I would just encourage you, those things are great, but just test them against Scripture, right? Just test them against Scripture.
Yeah. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6.
Yeah.
Lord, with all your heart, not lean on your own understanding.
Good. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. When you don't know, when you're confused and feel down on yourself for not being able to figure out, the Bible tells you not to lean on your own understanding. Lean on God.
Life is about relationships.
Okay.
The Bible is about relationships.
Yep, good. So the Bible is about relationships. Rick.
I think every man should read 1 and 2 Samuel about King David, especially the one when everybody went off to war and he stayed back.
Yeah, very good. Very good. Last one right here.
At some point in time, they have to come to Christ, though, because I think it's 2 Corinthians 2:14 says, the things of the Spirit our foolishness to them that don't have the Spirit.
That's right.
Because it is spiritually discerned. Without Christ, I don't see how that...
I think you're exactly right. He's quoting Paul when he said, basically, to the natural man, the things of the Spirit are folly, are foolishness, right? That's great. And so that's why we're pursuing Christ, right? We're pursuing Christ. But Christian isn't like a label. It's an identity. Do you see the difference? It's not a label. It's not a political party. It's not a religious background. It's an identity. It's who you are. And if you don't identify as a Christ follower, yeah, the things of the Spirit are going to seem like folly. Last one.
Speaking of David, you don't need the king's armor to take down the giant.
Ah, good. So when you feel like you can't, like you don't have the resources that you need, you go and you remember the story of David going out there, spurning the king's armor, right? I don't need the king's armor. Just give me some rocks and a sling, and I'm going after him, right? Awesome. That's great stuff. Well, let me say this, guys, sort of as a final word. I just want to remind you that the Bible relentlessly points to God. While the world relentlessly points us back to ourselves. The problem with the world's view is that deep in down, inside of our own mind, heart, and soul, we all know that we are an inadequate source of wisdom and truth. In other words, we know that we don't know. In fact, if we're honest, we know that we can't know on our own. We need the wisdom of God. So let me take you off the hook. If your feelings of inadequacy, they're not weakness, they're honesty. Focus on the truth that God reveals in His Scripture. You will live the life that you want to live. Let me say a quick prayer for us, and then I just want to recognize the first timers after I do that. So hold your seats just for a second. Father, teach us through your Scripture. Draw us close to yourself. Help us, Lord, to love being in your Word. Make it compelling to our hearts and our minds, Lord, so that we will study it and learn it and live it with all our strength. In Jesus' name, amen.